My name is Kim Higginson, and I am one of the lay leaders here at Trinity Anglican Church in Durham. Just a couple of announcements. On Tuesday of this week, October 18th, at 1 p.m., a small group is meeting at the church to turn over gardens, to trim the plants, clean the grounds, and generally prepare the outside of the church for what is about to happen in another 4 to 6 weeks. So anyways, if you'd like to join us, please do so. And as they say, many hands make light work. Reverend Jeff will also be joining us on Tuesday. And speaking of Reverend Jeff, he will be here next Sunday at 11 a.m. and will be officiating a Holy Eucharist service. And does anyone have anything else to announce this morning? All right. Let's begin our service by taking a few moments of quiet reflection. Let us be still as we draw near to worship God. Let us listen. God speaks even through the background noise of a very busy world. We acknowledge with respect that Bruce County and Gray County are situated on the traditional and treaty territory of the Anishinaabeg, the people of the Three Fires known as the Ojibwe, Odawa, and the Potawatomi Nations, and the homeland of the Chippewas of the Saugeen, the Chippewas of the Naishimeng, and the Métis. This territory is covered by the Upper Canada Treaties. May we all, as treaty people, live with respect on this land and live in peace and friendship with all its diverse peoples. Our opening hymn is number 318, Rejoice Today with One Accord. Dear friends in Christ, as we prepare to worship Almighty God, let us with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy. And now turning to page 46, Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The introductory responses are found on page 47. Lord, open our lips,
and our mouths shall proclaim your praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
And together, glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Hallelujah. The Spirit of the Lord renews the faith of the earth. O come, let us worship. Let us join together in singing of the 95th Psalm, found on page 49. We will say it together, alternating at the half verse. Come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us shout to the Lord, to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving.
And praise God, shout to him some songs.
For the Lord is a great God,
and a great King of all gods.
In his hands are all the caverns of the earth,
and the heights of the hills are his also.
The sea is his, for he made it,
and his hands have molded the dry land.
Come, let us bow down, and bend the knee,
and kneel before the Lord our Creator.
For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand.
Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice.
Please be seated for the reading of Scripture.
A reading from the book of Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will sow the house of Israel and the house of Judah with the seed of humans and the seed of animals. And just as I have watched over them to pluck up and break down, to overthrow, destroy, and bring evil, so I will watch over them to build and to plant, says the Lord. In those days, they shall no longer say, the parents have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. But all shall die for their own sins. The teeth of everyone who eats sour grapes shall be set on edge. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember sin no more. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. This morning
A reading from the second letter of Paul to Timothy. As for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings that are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing in his kingdom, I solemnly urge you, proclaim the message. Be persistent whether the time is favorable or unfavorable. Convince, rebuke, and encourage with the utmost patience in teaching. For the time is coming when people will not put up with the sound doctrine, but having itchy ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own desires and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander away to myths. As for you, always be sober, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, carry out your ministry fully. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our gradual hymn is number 506, Lord of All. He said, in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared nor had respect for people. In that city, there was a widow who kept coming to him and saying, "Grant me justice against my opponent." For a while he refused, but later he said to himself, "Though I have no fear of God and no respect for anyone, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice, so that she may not wear me out by continually coming." And the Lord said, "Listen to what the unjust judge says, and will not God grant justice to his chosen ones who cry to him day and night? Will he be delayed long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, he will find faith on earth." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. Just judge with those of God. an ungodly and unjust judge. If an ungodly and unjust judge answers with justice in the end, we are to be assured that God, who is all-loving and powerful, will listen to and answer those who are persistent in prayer. In September 1973, a 6-year-old girl attended her first day at school. Her name was Phyllis Webbestad. Before her first day at school, Phyllis went shopping with her grandmother to pick out a new school outfit. Phyllis chose a shiny orange shirt with a shoelace string at the front. She said it was bright and exciting, likely how she felt going to school for the first time. Upon her arrival at St. Joseph's Mission Residential School outside Williams Lake, B.C., Phyllis was stripped down and herded into a group shower filled with crying children. By day's end, her hair had been cut. Her new school outfit had been replaced with an ill-fitting and shabby communal uniform, and she had been assigned the dormitory bed where she would sleep for the next 10 months of the school term. Despite her pleas for the return of her orange shirt, Phyllis never saw it again. It was taken from her, and it is believed it ended up in the school incinerator. We hear so many stories about people around the globe who are suffering and who are just trying to cope with the challenges they face in their day-to-day living. These are the widow in today's parable. People looking for something different in their lives, a better life. They are hoping that things will change, but more often than not, nothing does change. It is not fair. We know it, and God knows it. All of us find ourselves standing before an unjust judge at some time or another. The unjust judge has many faces. He is masked and sometimes hard to recognize. She is veiled, cloaked, and wears many disguises, like bigotry, hatred, sickness, disease, hunger, cruelty, violence, exploitation, unjust laws, and corrupt institutions. Of the many forms in which the unjust judge manifests him or herself, there is no room for compassion, kindness, or respect for another's well-being. Appearing before an unjust judge is intimidating and overwhelming. You feel helpless. There is no lawyer or advocate to speak on your behalf. You are alone and completely on your own. What happens when you stand before the unjust judge? Some give up and yield to what the unjust judge says or does, accepting that life will never get better. Some will get angry and become hardened and indifferent, like the unjust judge. Some will blame God for being distant and unjust. And there will be others who will trust God and, like the widow, persevere. Jesus told his disciples to pray always and not to lose heart. That is the powerful message of the persistent widow. She is relentless in pleading her story and seeking justice. She is tireless in laying herself and her pain before the unjust judge. sit back and wait for God to fix things. To pray always and not to lose heart means to make our petitions and supplications to God. Do what we can to bring about a change or better outcome, and then trust the rest to God's will. Jesus' words to his disciples reveal that God is the complete opposite of the unjust judge. He is listening, he does have compassion, and he is ever present along our journey. The widow's story involves waiting. Nobody likes to wait. But the widow does not wait for God. She waits with God. And she waits for his timing and his purpose. Her trust and faith in God gives her courage. Her trust and faith in God sustain her in her waiting. To pray always is what keeps her from losing heart, keeps her continually showing up before the unjust judge. It would be gut-wrenching and heartbreaking if the widow gave up and missed the day when the unjust judge finally ruled in her favor. The persistent widows are the lowly and the distressed of our world. The unjust judges are the people, circumstances, and conditions that stand in the way of righteousness, kindness, compassion, and respect. Jesus said to his disciples 2,000 years ago, to pray always and not to lose heart. These words are of tremendous encouragement for us and are why it is important to have a deep and personal relationship with God. The widow's faith is a profound example for us to follow. To live the widow's resolve is not easy, but with prayer and perseverance, we will be able to stand before any unjust judge, whatever shape or form, and confront inequality and injustice, and know that God is watching. In May of 2013, the St. Joseph Mission Commemoration Project brought together residential school survivors and their families at Williams Lake, B.C. The event was to raise awareness of the residential school experience, to honor survivors, remember the children who died, and begin a process for healing and reconciliation. Phyllis Webstad is a Northern Shuswap from the Sitchreckum Exgadam First Nation, located in the interior of BC. She spoke at this event, sharing her story of having her orange shirt taken away from her on the first day of school. She said, "I didn't understand why they wouldn't give it back to me. It was mine. The color orange has always reminded me of that, and how my feelings didn't matter, how no one cared, and how I felt like I was worth nothing. All of us little children were crying, and no one cared." From Phyllis Webstad's speech came the idea to adopt the orange shirt as a symbol of awareness and remembrance. The organizers of the Williams Lake Commemoration Project launched a Canada-wide annual Orange Shirt Day as a way to invite others to join the conversation about the legacy of residential schools. September 30th is Orange Shirt Day, and it recognizes the tragic legacy of residential schools, the missing children, the families left behind, and the survivors. The poignant slogan of the orange shirt has become "Every Child Matters." National Day for Truth and Reconciliation happens to coincide with Orange Shirt Day. And this year marked the second National Day for Truth and Reconciliation across Canada. September 30th was chosen because it was the time of year when First Nations, Inuit, and Métis children were legally and authoritatively taken from the homes and forced into residential schools. Phyllis Webstad is married, has one son, a stepson, and five grandchildren. She is founder of and the ambassador for the Orange Shirt Society. She tours the country telling her story and raising awareness about the impacts of the residential school system. She has published two books, Orange Shirt Day and Phyllis's Orange Shirt. Phyllis Webstad has been standing before an unjust judge since she was 6 years old. Like the widow, she is persistent. In the telling of the story of her orange shirt, Phyllis is bringing about justice for herself, countless others, and many of whom never had a voice. And I think I will leave it there on this, the 19th Sunday after Pentecost. Amen. conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Martha will now lead us in the prayers of the people. Please sit or kneel as you are most comfortable.
Believing that the power of God working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine, let us lift up our prayers and petitions to God. Our response to "We pray to the Lord" is, "Lord, hear our prayer." Thank you for the gift of faith and our Anglican traditions. We pray that church leaders, clergy, and those in special ministries guide your church and its faithful according to your holy purpose. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We give thanks for our new priest in charge, the Reverend Jeff Kishek, and our assistant priest, the Reverend Ann Bavera Davinsky. We give thanks for your presence whenever two or three are gathered together in your name, and the special gift of being in this sacred space today as a congregation of faith, worshiping in person and together through social media. We ask that you look with favor on Trinity Anglican Church and continue to inspire its purpose and calling. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Our world seems to be a very scary place these days. Lord Jesus, you came among us to bring peace on earth. We pray that the leaders of the nations and people everywhere turn to you, the Prince of Peace, so that war and terror, cruelty and persecution, hatred and indifference end, so that all people across the world can live their lives in safety, harmony, and happiness. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We remember the needs of so many in our family, community, and across the globe. Those whose lives in recent weeks have been shattered by natural disasters. Those who are in distress in any way. All those who are in need of your power working in their lives this day. We take a moment to pray, either silently or aloud, for those who are in our thoughts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that you watch over our country Canada, our province of Ontario, the counties of Grey and Bruce, and the town of Durham. As we approach Municipal Election Day, we ask that you guide all those in authority to govern for the good of all, that they be just judges in our world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for those who have lost loved ones recently or who continue to struggle with the loss of someone dear. We ask that you comfort them in their grief and that you heal the brokenhearted. We take a moment to remember the faithful departed who are on our minds this morning. We pray that they are with the angels praising you and enjoying their heavenly reward. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that you ever be present along our journey, that you bestow upon us, in addition to our daily needs, faith, courage, fortitude, and perseverance to lead lives that are just and which are pleasing to you in your sight. Help us open our hearts and offer our talents to bring comfort and hope to all in your holy name. Amen.
Our thoughts and prayers are with our sisters and brothers in the Ukraine and the surrounding countries in their fear and distress. We pray, too, for all other regions of the world where there is conflict, unrest, and oppression. We pray that reconciliation will overcome hatred, peace will conquer war, hope will replace despair, and that your plans for the region will be fulfilled. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen. Let's gather our intentions and the focus of our worship with the prayer of the day. Almighty and everlasting God, in Christ you have revealed your glory among the nations. Preserve the works of your mercy, that your church throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Let's say together.